Morning, church. Welcome back. Appreciate you tuning in, being with us for our devotional series, Enjoy, as we're looking through the book of Philippians, verse by verse, trying to give some insight on the joy of the Lord and on a practical level. And yesterday, we kind of left off with Paul's exhortation to these Philippians, trying to keep Jesus Christ in the forefront, having him as our focus of our joy, rejoicing in him, rejoicing in the Lord, not in the things that we have or the pursuits that we go after, but having the Lord himself as the focus of our joy. And we gave some warnings there. He kind of started off building this argument about pursuing false religion. We talked about how that he's going to contrast a works-based righteousness versus a spiritual righteousness, or a faith-based righteousness, which is where real value comes from. And we're going to move along into the next section here, or the next part of this section, verses 4 through 6, where Paul kind of lifts himself up as an example of his pedigree. He's going to talk about a pedigree, things he used to pursue. And he's not saying this in a positive light, in the sense of, hey, man, I really missed out on this stuff. He's painting this as, these are the things that I went after, and but there was a big change in my life. I'm not pursuing those things anymore. And he's not speaking theoretically here. He's going to speak from his own experience of how God changed him and certainly changed his perspective on things. And so Philippians chapter 3, verse 4 through 6, he says, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more. He says, if we want to go down the list of things, of pursuits and accomplishments and accolades, Paul says, man, I had it all. And then he lists out several of these things. Circumcised the eighth day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, as touching the law of Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. And that's a big list there. But essentially, when he says circumcised the eighth day, this just meant that he was of the strictest of the Jews. The strictest Jews would follow to the letter the Levitical law of on the eighth day after a son was born, they would have to circumcise him in the temple. And that's, his parents brought him up with the intent of religious excellence. And they, from birth, brought him into that vein of the path that he was going to be on and pursuing these religious things. Now, of the stock of Israel, that's basically, he says, I'm the cream of the crop. I was part of the all-star team, if you will. Tribe of Benjamin, this was an exalted and honored tribe. Not all the tribes had a great name to speak of. A lot of them were guilty of a lot of sinful practices. The tribe of Dan, for example, was infamous for introducing idolatry into the northern tribes. But the tribe of Benjamin followed Judah in that split back in with Rehoboam, the son of Solomon. He took over for his father, and Solomon passed off the scene. Rehoboam took the throne, and you know the story there where he listened to the counsel of his peers instead of the wiser, older men that served with his father. And his peers advised him to just run roughshod over everybody and treat them like they were slaves. And so he gets up and gives this speech, and it just sounds like just a, you know, a jerk. And in response, Jeroboam on the other side said, we don't have anything to do with you. And from that point on, the nation split into two nations, the 10 tribes of the north and Judah in the south, along with Benjamin. Benjamin went with Judah in preserving the godly line as much as possible. And never again would the northern tribes of northern Israel have a good godly king. All of them were pagan. All of them were evil. All of them were wicked. And Judah in the south, Judah and Benjamin, those two tribes that formed what was known as Judah, they would occasionally have good godly kings. They didn't always, but occasionally they would have good godly kings. But Benjamin was known as being an exalted tribe. Benjamin and Joseph were the favorite kids of Abraham. Or of Jacob, I should say. Saul, Israel's first king, came from Benjamin. During Absalom's rebellion to David, this tribe stayed faithful to the king, and so on and so forth. So Benjamin was an exalted tribe. It was an honored tribe. And that was the tribe that that Paul was from. He calls himself a Hebrew of the Hebrews. Now, this was a special reference to the Jews who spoke Aramaic and who worshipped in Hebrew-speaking congregations. This would have been different. Now, this doesn't mean a whole lot to us because we don't really deal with these types of issues, but back then it meant a lot to them because the Hellenists were the Greek-speaking Hebrews who were seen as kind of the compromisers. They were seen as the worldly line of Jews from the Hellenist or from the Hebrew-speaking Jews. They would look at the Hellenists as watered down, worldly, giving into things, not holding to traditions, not holding to what the Bible was telling them to do. So a Hebrew of Hebrews indicated an Aramaic-speaking observant Jew whose parents were also Hebrews. So he says, I am a Hebrew of the Hebrews. I am part of that dedicated, strict, understandably godly, if you understand what I'm saying there, godly line of Hebrews, at least in that world, in that sphere of understanding back then. And so they would have seen him as very respectable in the way he does things. And so he had this pedigree. He said, I have all these things. He says, now, touching the law, a Pharisee. Now, a Pharisee, we think of a Pharisee as a hypocrite. That's kind of what the term got used, get developed into, because how Jesus just blasted the Pharisees in their hypocrisy. But understand that the Pharisee was the very educated, and they were the elite religious leaders of the day. They would have been the ones that believed the Bible and knew the Bible more than anybody else. And so Paul was educated, and he was educated amongst all the high up rabbis of his time. Gamaliel was a leading teacher of the day that Paul sat under and learned from him. These different ones would have trained him up, and he had all this. His relationship to Israel's enemies, he talks about there. He says concerning zeal, persecuting the church. He said, you want to talk about being a zealous person? Man, as far as that world was concerned and how, you know, Israel would have viewed having zeal, I was at the top of it because I was persecuting the church, because in that mindset, the church was the enemy of Israel in the beginning. And so Paul says, man, I was going after it. I had everything. He says blameless. He calls himself blameless. Touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. Though every Jew could boast of his bloodline, Paul could also boast of his accomplishments. And how could this man be wrong? And he had all these different things. But the problem was, is he was using the wrong measuring stick. And that really is the point that he's trying to get across here, is what are you measuring righteousness by? You going to measure it by your works? Because if that's the measuring stick, well, we might be able to compete with one another. And that really is the idea here of what he's laying down, is competition between man and man, human to human. And Paul could boast of all of them. He could brag of all his accomplishments as it compares to other people. But that's not the measuring stick God holds us to. He holds us to his measuring stick, a different righteousness. And all of us fail that one. And because that measuring stick is perfection. Jesus talked to the Pharisees on the Sermon on the Mount, and he says, talking about, you know, you've heard you shouldn't do this, but if you have this in your heart, you're already guilty of it, and kind of goes back and forth and back and forth. And then he says this, be therefore perfect as my Father in heaven is perfect. In other words, if you want to have works as the basis for you going to heaven and merit, your own self-merit as the basis for going to heaven, here's the standard. Here's the measuring stick. Perfection. That's not, in that context, that is not, he's not talking about maturity. He's talking about God's perfection. If you want to match up righteousness to righteousness, man's righteousness compared with God's righteousness, we're all failures. Because God's righteousness is perfection. When Jesus is talking to the rich young ruler, and he comes to Jesus and says, hey, master, what do I have to do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus kind of plays along with him. He says, well, keep the commandments. And he says, oh, which ones? Because I've kept all these. And Jesus, he lists off a few of them. And the rich young ruler says, oh, yeah, I've done all those things. And Jesus said this. He says, if thou wilt be perfect, in other words, if you want to be perfect, fine. Let me give you this one. Go sell all your stuff and give it to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven. And the young man went away sorrowful, for he had a lot of wealth. He had much riches. And God, Jesus was putting his finger on his covetousness, the fact that he really wasn't as perfect as he thought he was, because his ultimate God was his possessions. And things had crept into his heart, and that really was at the seat of the seat of his heart was his materialism and his covetousness. And so this backdrop, Paul uses to illustrate to us the uselessness and endless pursuit of things. And it's tragic. Whether those things are tangible or intangible, these things cannot save us, and they can't bring us joy. You know, I appreciate, my wife doesn't like me using her as an example, but she really is a wonderful testimony to me. When we were dating, and I got saved, and she rededicated her life to the Lord, and we started growing together in our faith and serving the Lord together, came a point in my Christian life where God called me to preach. And we had already talked about getting married. We wanted to spend the rest of our lives together, and we wanted to serve the Lord together. At the time, my wife had in school, she had a full ride scholarship to George Washington University to study medicine, and she had the grades to back it up, and she easily could have gotten in and gone and done very well there. And she was kind of pursuing that and going after that. And that when God came and touched my heart and touched her heart, God had a way of changing and reevaluating priorities in us. And I wanted to serve the Lord. She wanted to serve the Lord, and she wanted to serve the Lord with me. And she walked away from that. And she doesn't talk about that. I talk about it because I like to brag on her faith, because that's a testimony to me. And I see the Apostle Paul very much in that story, how she was willing to walk away from that because she wanted to live for the Lord. And here's what it comes down to, not to lift her up in so much, but here's the point I'm trying to make. It's a matter of reevaluating what is truly of value. And that's the point that Paul's making here. All of these pursuits, all these things, yeah, they have their place. And he's not saying it's wrong to be a professional this or a professional that and to be successful. He's not even saying that that's a sinful thing. But what he's saying is this: if that becomes your God, that is a very sinful thing. And what is the center of our joy? It's not in things, it's in Christ, and it's in pursuing Christ. Certainly, God wants you to do the best at everything you do. He wants you to apply yourself. He wants you to, whatever he puts into your hand, do it to the glory of God. But it's to the glory of God. It's not to your glory. It's not to build your name. It's not to build your reputation. It's not to build your accolades and all these things that fade and that rust and that disappear. Jesus Christ and his glory is what's eternal. And we find our true joy in that pursuit. And so I want to encourage you today, whatever it is you find yourself doing, help that, let that be the center focal point of everything you do. Bring honor and glory to Jesus Christ. Let him be what you're pursuing after. And God promises to give you joy. Hope you join us tomorrow. Have a wonderful day. God bless.